Good morning.
That was great.
All right. Thank you all so much for joining us this morning. We went out to a few events last night, earlier this morning. And the number of people were out last night, I'm surprised that we have this many that made it here before 9 o'clock. So I want to give you all a round of applause for being in this room. I'm always very excited to host the Black Male Achievement Panel at the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation. And this year is actually bittersweet to me because since 2006, the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation has had continuous African-American male achievement events since 2007. I've personally been hosting them. Many of you all know that I just accepted an appointment by President Obama to be the Deputy Director of the White House Initiative on HBCUs. Thank you. So that's a position I'm very excited about, and I know it's going to give me the opportunity to elevate the work that I've been doing over these years on black male achievement. And hopefully I'll be able to participate in a convening like this next year, because I don't think this is a time to stop the conversations. But in 2006, I just moved to Washington, D.C., accepted a position at Howard University, and got a fellowship at the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation. I was an assistant professor, pre-tenure. And I must admit, I had somewhat of a naive understanding of black male issues at that time. There were different stats that I would hear, and I believed a lot of them. There were media reports about the plight of black males, and I pretty much took all of them at face value. And so one of the things I wanted to do when I came into the foundation was to write a report that looked at black male achievement. But I didn't really have a firm idea of what that report would look like. But I got access to a lot of different data sets. And what I assumed I would see when I started to dig into the data were a lot of the problems that black males have. And so when I did comparisons between black males and white males, I just assumed that in most indicators, I would see black males at the bottom of the categories associated with success and at the top of the categories associated with failures, because that's all that I had been reading at the time. But the more I started to analyze data, the more nuanced the data became. Another thing that was happening at the same time I was analyzing the data for the first Breaking Barriers report was I was invited to be a judge of a writing contest called Mile in My Shoes, where I read the essays of African-American male high school students. And this was an essay contest that was started by an author in South Carolina. And she just decided to put up $200 of her own money. You know, not a lot of money, but she put up $200 of her own money and put out a call for essay contributions from black males because she wanted them to tell their own story because she was tired of the media telling their story. And so as I read these essays and analyzed my data, the picture that I was getting from the data became so much more clear. I remember reading, I remember analyzing different factors, mental health factors that might be associated with success among black males. And I remember this factor called tired in the morning came up to be one of the strongest indicators of success among black males. And I constantly reanalyzed that, and I was like, you know, why is this coming up so high? I did a stepwise multiple regression analysis, so there was about two dozen factors that I was analyzing, and tired in the morning came up number two. And then I read an essay, and this kid, he wrote, he said, I think sometimes we don't get enough sleep and can't concentrate during class. And you know, when you come to school and you can't concentrate, your teachers think that you're dumb, and that gives people further reason to believe that black males don't know anything. So that was the way, and I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but that was the essence of what he was saying. So he was sensitive to the issue, and he was also sensitive to people's perception of him. So when I wrote the, when I put out the first Breaking Barriers report, I used block quotes of the different kids. And I also decided to examine my analytic strategy. And so what I did was, instead of focusing on comparisons between races, I decided to focus my attention. I think somebody's trying to get in. Is it locked? But I started to focus my attention on, that's actually my wife that I was trying to get in. Make that adjustment. So instead of focusing on the comparison between black males and white males or other race groups, I decided to make high-achieving black males the center of the analysis. Because when I think about what it takes for young black males to succeed, I'm not really thinking, like, what's going on in my mind doesn't look like what it takes for white males to achieve. When I think about kids who are going through gang-ridden neighborhoods, but they're still able to succeed in school, when I talk to them, they're saying things like, in my neighborhood, if you put shoes across your shoulders, then the gangs don't really try to recruit you because they know you have something else in mind. And I'm hearing things like, gangs have talked to me, but I always let them know that they could do something better. And I know that when I talk to them about my goals and how I plan to make money, and it sounds more logical than what they're trying to do, they get it. So, when we think about advice like, stay away from the wrong crowd, that doesn't even apply to young black males. Because a lot of them are in densely populated areas. The communalism in those areas is so strong, you can't stay away from the wrong crowd. You have to be able to influence the wrong crowd and negotiate with the wrong crowd and elevate others. So the paradigm is something very different. Also, when I think about the evolution of the conversations I've had with all of my colleagues up here, and just about everybody up here are personal friends of mine. This was, since I knew this was might be the last time I have this much control, I invited all of my friends, like all of my personal friends. But luckily, my personal friends are dynamic, and we've been having these conversations over the last 6 years. And we've looked at the policies, we've looked at different changes that's in the pipeline, like Common Core standards. We've looked at these district level initiatives. When we first started this work, there weren't districts that would have a black male program. Back then, they were still saying that they couldn't legally do it. But now we see black male initiatives in New York. We see black male initiatives in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and Oakland, California. So as we think about legislative action to expand black male achievement, we have to consider what works and what might not work, because everything that comes from Congress isn't good for our kids. We are all seeing the effects of No Child Left Behind. We can anticipate some of the flaws of Common Core standards. And the panel is going to talk mostly about this, but one of my biggest problems with Common Core standards is it doesn't really touch the curriculum in and of itself. It just touches how kids are supposed to learn. But when you have schools that omit Algebra 2, schools that omit physics and calculus, and so you've been assigned to the school by the state, but this school is putting you in a position not to be competitive at state universities, these are laws that we need to change. Not dress it up with some fancy language as with Common Core standards. So we're going to discuss all of this. So I'm going to turn it over to a brother who I've become very familiar with over the last years, because we're in the same space. We're both active advocates for education, for educating black kids. And he has a very busy schedule, high demand, but he graciously took time out to moderate this session. And Brother Jeff Johnson, he's a Washington-based award-winning journalist, social activist, and political commentator. From his celebrated conversations with marquee world figures in political, business, and entertainment arenas, to his grassroots trench work to inspire the next generation of leaders, investigative journalists, political correspondents, and activists, Jeff continues to be a trailblazer, social entrepreneur, and authentic voice for change. And just on a personal level, this brother is one of the most eloquent, gifted orators I know. And the way that he connects history to where we are today is something that's very, very profound. So I'm happy to turn over the session to my brother Jeff Johnson and this dynamic panel right here. So give it up.
Thank you, Dr. Tolson. It's really an honor and privilege to be here. I think when many of us in this room, and especially I know the panelists, when Congressional Black Caucus comes around, you get 1,000 invitations to do all kinds of panels, normally all starting exactly at the same time. But when I got the invitation from Dr. Tolson, it was one of the ones that I really wanted to take because I don't know how to do anything but be honest. So often, the panels lack substance, lack direction, lack focus, and lack really pragmatic recommendations and solutions that come out of them. And I have so appreciated the work that he has done, but I've also appreciated that in private conversations that we've had, the research that he's done and his conviction has actually shifted my thinking and how I look at some of these issues and even where I want to expend some of my own personal resources. So I'm thankful for his work. I'm thankful for his growing friendship and appreciative to be part of this panel, which is really going to examine the relationship between executive initiatives and legislative actions to promote policy advocacy and best practices to improve academic outcomes for school-age Black males, publicly funded alternatives to public schools, school closure, and evolving standards such as Common Core are government-influenced actions that are reshaping education in the United States. And so emerging charter schools and district-level Black male initiatives, and really so much of what Dr. Tolson really went into, puts us in a place where we've got to start thinking critically, moving strategically, challenging, I think, as it's already been said, some of the reactionary policy that we see, and more importantly, recommending policy that makes sense. And so we have a fantastic panel, many of whom you already know. I hope that all of you that have smartphones will Google them, because I am not going to read their entire bio so that we can get right to the discussion. I'm sure the panelists are okay with that?
Sure. Yep.
Wonderful. You know, sometimes we get to panels and you spend half the panel introducing the panelists.
Right.
So it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Sean Harper. He's director of the Center for the Study of Race and Equity in Education at the University of Pennsylvania. Dr. Lamont Flowers, executive director, Charles H. Houston Center for the Study of the Black Experience. Dr. Brian Marks, executive director of the Morehouse Research Institute at Morehouse College. Dr. H. Richard Milner IV, director of the Pitt Center for Urban Education, the University of Pittsburgh. Dr. James L. Moore III, director, Todd Anthony Bell National Resource Center on the African American Male at the Ohio State University. And Adriana Villavicencio.
Villavicencio. That's correct.
Thank you. I just want to make sure I had it right. Research Associate, Research Alliance for New York City Schools. And so the way this will work is each panelist will have 5 minutes to make brief remarks from a specific area, and then we'll open the floor. I'll ask a couple of questions, but I really want you all to be able to engage this panel with the questions that you all have. And so we will begin with Dr. Harper, who's going to discuss the dismantling deficit thinking and promoting success among school-age Black males.
Thanks a lot, Jeff.
and thanks, Ivory, for pulling together. Only you could pull together this cast of scholars. So I thank you for this opportunity to also play with my friends in this space. I got to tell you that I'm very familiar with that tired in the morning factor in your research. I'm struggling with it right now. I want to spend just a few minutes talking about sort of refocusing the way we think about policy and practice to promote the success of school-age boys, and sort of pushing back against this prism of deficits through which policy is often approached and created. Last November, the center I direct at Penn co-produced with the Institute for Higher Education Policy here in DC a report that included several forward-thinking recommendations for policymakers. The report was about getting more black male students to and through higher education. Now, I got to tell you that the substance of that report was largely framed around bad statistics, very alarming gaps and inequities, and just a lot of bad news about brothers in both K-12 and higher ed. When we got ready to write the policy recommendations, my co-author and I, we struggled a bit, right? Because we were thinking these are the same old statistics, the same durable patterns of inequities that we see across the country. So therefore, how can we move beyond just offering the same old recommendations that have been offered repeatedly by social scientists and education researchers? Ultimately, we came up with what we think are some compelling suggestions. Now, I want to sort of shift gears here. That was in November. Starting in March, this past March, the center, in collaboration with the New York City Department of Education, as a part of its expanded success initiative, undertook a study in 40 public high schools across New York City. We were studying black and Latino males who are college-bound and college-ready. These are all juniors and seniors. The seniors had all been accepted to college by the time we interviewed them. They for sure were going to college. The juniors had already taken a sequence of courses that would qualify them for admission to a four-year institution, and they were very clear that they too were going to college. We believed, in approaching that study, that there were such young men in those schools. Despite the headlines that we hear about urban high schools, the hopelessness with which black and Latino males have been notoriously caricatured, right? If we pay attention to that stuff, we would believe that nobody in none of these schools is going to college, right? That they're just these hopeless dumping grounds for talent among young men of color. We easily, with the help of Paul Forbes, who is the director of ESI for New York City, he's here. With the help of Paul and the Department of Education, we easily found across those 40 high schools 325 of these young men whom we interviewed individually to understand how is it that they were able to resist the seductive lure of joining gangs, for example. How is it that they've come from deeply, deeply impoverished families and communities, but yet managed to still come to school every day and succeed? How is it that they managed to navigate a curriculum in their schools and become college ready and college bound? We thought that was perhaps a more instructive way to approach the study of young men of color. So on September 30th, we're releasing the report from that study in New York City. And I got to tell you that a couple days ago, I'm sort of like racing against the clock here. I was racing against the clock to finish writing this. I couldn't stop writing the recommendations from that study. I wrote 20 single-spaced pages of recommendations that emerged. And I said to you that last November, that report that we released, my co-author and I were sort of struggling a bit about, all right, well, how can we offer something different here for policymakers? I got to tell you that taking this anti-deficit view and understanding what works, what helped these young men to succeed in high school and navigate their ways to college, produced for us a seemingly never-ending set of recommendations. So I just argued that if we do more of the latter and actually pursue insights into policies and practices that make a difference in the lives of young men of color, that we will see more success among them, and we will create better policies and practices.
Thanks so much. Next, I want to go to Dr. Moore, discuss the potential and the impact of evolving standards such as Common Core and other federal and district level actions on the academic success of black males.
First of all, I just want to also thank Dr. Tolson for inviting me. It's always a pleasure. He's certainly one of the luminaries in the field, and certainly we want him to do well when he take on this new post. But nevertheless, the Common Core is a very salient topic right now in the educational community. It's supposed to be the lifeline, the life preserver that's going to revolutionize education. And so I think the Common Core is a starting point. And it's a starting point. It's a way to ensure that every classroom, every school system, and every educational system, students are going to be exposed to the same kinds of content. But I am somewhat reluctant because I've been in a number of schools, whether suburban, urban, or rural school systems, and I'm not convinced that the Common Core is going to be the lifeline like the national discourse is kind of presenting, how they present this information. And I say this because we know all AP is not created equally. And as I tell my students, even at Ohio State, you may get the same degree, but you didn't really get the same degree. And I think we all can bear witness to that. We too frequently, we get students who may say that I'm taking this class, and then when they matriculate at places like where we are, they realize that their class, their AP in chemistry was not quite the same as AP in this other school system, which I would like to say, and that's another commentary, that that's educational malpractice. And so I think the Common Core will be another way, because part of it, when I think about education, it really doesn't cost as much as people think. It's the time and it's will, right? Because when I look at the students, and we did an evaluation many years ago when Governor Strickland was a governor of Ohio, and that's when everybody's running to Ohio. Now you all don't come, don't patronize and bring money to the state anymore. But nevertheless, the governor, Ohio, I like to say, is more probably one of the most progressive states, and I know New York City just put some money into the black males, but that's the city. We don't really say that's New York, right? But Ohio, the state, put $20 million into the achievement gap specifically for black males, because we realized that if we improve graduation rate by 5%, that our state would save $200 million. So as Henry Levin would suggest in his work, it's an economic imperative, not just a social justice issue for black males. And so the Common Core is a starting point. But I think we need to go even beyond that, because what I know, and I have an ed psych, my work kind of pulls from educational psychology, and we know many black males who have the aptitude. That's our nephew, that's our brother, that's our uncle. The boy is smart, but he didn't get the good grades, right? And that's a trend across the country. So we spend a lot of time on skills. So I'm a big person skill, because some of us think all we gotta do is take the kid out of the neighborhood and his life is gonna change. But if you don't have skill, I tell you, you ain't gonna have long-term success. So two things that I think the Common Core needs to focus on, but no one is really talking about it. It's two things of success that is really critical: skill and will. And most of the things that are affecting black males is not skill, but it plays out in skill, because when we look at their test scores, we'll say, man, they're not getting the test scores. They just don't have the ability. They got gaps in their learning. Well, you know, Dr. Flowers and I just did a study. We just completed this project. It's an NSF. And we're talking about STEM students, microbiology, chemistry, computer science. And we asked these black males the qualitative side: how many hours do you spend studying? Now count homework over a 7-day period of time. The qualitative is 4 hours. And these are people who are in college. Then went on the quantitative, and I think we surveyed about 600-700 students, if my memory serves me correctly. They only study in 5 hours a week. And so the racial group that studies more than any racial group in the United States is what group? Everybody know it. I didn't tell you that. It's in the air. But the ones who are getting in Berkeley and some of these places is time on task. And you know, if you play sports, your coach, if you play basketball, my coach could tell us to go into drills. He didn't even have to tell us. We were socialized that we were going to do it. We were like little mice running around, right? We gave up our brain. Young men are not developing the academic, scholastic kinds of behaviors that ensures their success. So I would say, and I close, the Common Core must focus on will as well as skill. Confidence doesn't produce competence, but competence produce confidence. And these brothers competent, so that's why they're confident. And I'll close on that.
Thank you so much. Dr. Villavicencio, discuss district-level black male initiatives such as Expanded Success Initiative in New York that demonstrates some promise for black male achievement.
Thanks, Jeff Johnson, and thank you, Ivory, for putting me on this panel with such esteemed scholars doing this work in their field. So I just wanted to walk back a little bit from the Expanded Success Initiative, which Sean Harper just mentioned, and talk about YMI, which is one of the nation's probably largest comprehensive initiative focused exclusively on young men of color. YMI is a $127 million effort funded by Mayor Bloomberg, the Open Society Foundation, and more than a dozen city agencies in New York City. And its goal is to improve outcomes along four different dimensions: health, justice, employment, and education. And so the biggest education component of YMI is this ESI. And as Sean mentioned, ESI is focused in 40 New York City public high schools, provides them monetary resources, but also professional development around academics, youth development, and college and career readiness. So what we're doing also with the approach of what actually works, what are schools doing that will actually have an impact on the kinds of things that we care about for kids? And we've found, we're still finalizing our year one impact results, both on academic outcomes such as test scores and credit accumulation, but also on non-academic outcomes like attendance rates, rates of suspension, and student self-efficacy, this will and confidence that you just mentioned. But while we're finalizing that, we've also found some interesting findings on the ground about what these schools are doing differently, how they're using ESI funds to actually make a difference with their students. And I'll just highlight three high-level things here. The first prominent strategy that they're using is mentoring. Specifically peer mentoring. A lot of these schools are pairing up, for example, 11th grade students, 11th grade boys with 9th grade students, or the 11th graders are actually leading or facilitating these small advisory classes with small groups of, let's say, 10 or so boys. And the schools that are implementing this most successfully, I would say, are partnering with outside community organizations that actually train the peer mentors and provide curriculum so that they are able to better talk about difficult issues that arise in their lives and how to transition from middle school to high school and also high school to college. The second prominent strategy that I'll talk about is college supports. A lot of these schools were already providing college-related programming, but I think what ESI funding has done is allow them to expand college-related programming to their 9th grade students. The rationale being that junior and senior year is probably far too late to start thinking about the steps to get to college. And the third thing that I think is probably the most unique about ESI is this culturally relevant, a real focus on culturally relevant education. So we all see these programs and initiatives come up. They put a lot of money in them. And what they do is just kind of expand programs or create new programs that we've seen a million times before. But what I think ESI, specifically Paul's team, is doing is really encouraging schools and sometimes pushing schools to have these frank, sometimes uncomfortable conversations conversations about race and gender. So one school in particular actually had their students videotape themselves talking pretty candidly about what it was like to be a black and Latino young male in a school that with teachers that were predominantly white and female. And this was pretty eye-opening for the teachers who actually sat and watched the video and talked about it among themselves at staff meetings. And one of the teachers told us when we went back and interviewed that ESI is actually allowing them for the first time to have these conversations, to address and confront their own personal prejudices, their biases, and overall lack of knowledge about the students that they serve. And so, as I said, we'll be releasing our final report on year one in January, February 2014, a lot slower than Sean Harper's team has been. I'll just end by saying that these schools, I think what ESI so far is showing is that principals and teachers can strategically use funding and resources and training to better serve their young men of color, not just by enhancing programs and services, but actually encouraging students and staff to become agents of change in their school community. And so we're excited to see what happens next year as we unfold the four-year evaluation.
Fantastic. Thanks so much. Dr. Marks, can you discuss the pros and cons of publicly funded alternatives to public schools?
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
All right, so in addition to being a scholar, I'm also a Baptist preacher, so I need y'all to talk back to me. It's the morning time, but we need to be engaged. All right, so I also want to acknowledge Ivory and all the work that you've done. Many of us, I'm sure, use your reports at the ready. I distribute them on a regular basis and quote the data quite often. I wish you the best, you know, in your new post. And you will be missed in this forum, but I'm sure we will still be in contact and supporting each other as we go forward. So really, a lot of this conversation comes down to intentions and self-interest. Right, so the intent, if you're talking about alternatives, publicly funded alternatives to traditional public schools, so charters, vouchers, online free schools, magnet schools to a certain extent, the intent, if you think about charter schools, was good. Let's start an incubator, a lab sort of system, experiment, identify some best practices, and let that spread to the surrounding traditional schools so that everyone can increase, right? Everyone can get better. That seems to happen pretty rarely, and that's unfortunate. The intent was good, right? Why doesn't it happen more often? That's when you have some self-interest that may creep in. And the self-interest comes from a variety of perspectives. There's actually some self-interest, and not all charter schools are high-performing, and we all know that. All right, when you compare them on average, there's good ones, there's bad ones, they open, they close, and so forth. But if you have a highly effective, high-performing charter school, it may be a situation where they like that privileged position. Why share all this good stuff and make these schools around me even better? Then I'm not the positive outlier anymore. Right, so there's self-interest there. Then you have the traditional schools in the environment that may say, well, we don't want to have to defer or go to them to learn. I know how to educate, you get a new principal, I don't need to go to that charter school. Yeah, they have best practices, they're different. So they may not be open to receiving feedback from the charter who has a highly effective practice. That's ego and that's pride. It's not always about the kids. Let me say that again. Oftentimes, much of this work is not about the best interests and academic achievement of kids, especially black males. A lot of what we have is not a child problem or a student problem, it's an adult problem. So we need to embrace and understand all these dynamics, because we all have self-interest that we bring to the table. So, but again, I mean, the intent of that charter piece, we understand and it's good, but the application of it doesn't necessarily play out. Now, in terms of innovation, so a charter school may innovate, have a great practice, right? But the notion is not all innovations that take place within a charter system are replicable at a traditional public school. The traditional public school just literally may not be structured to do some of those things. Longer school day, longer school year, merit-based pay. With these other things you may look at, the other traditional schools aren't structured to do those things. Okay, so then the policy comes in, the district leader has to say, okay, if I identify a best practice at a charter, am I going to give traditional schools the freedom and flexibility to incorporate these things in a way that makes sense for their school? but I may not be reelected to the school board. Oh, this may not go over well. Oh, and then the self-interest comes in, right? Now, we also understand that, this whole education reform movement is big business. There's a lot of people making a lot of money. And once you insert a profit motive into a system, it almost automatically runs the risk of being corrupted, prison industrial complex. Talk about black males. If I'm a shareholder in an institution that builds prisons, what do I want? More prisons. Who's easiest to put into those prisons? Black and brown males. So now there's a profit motive assigned with warehousing and jailing a population of people, right? And we know about the relationship between the lack of education and, entry into prison. So some charter schools that are highly effective, there's not enough of them to go around. Literally, there's just not enough. It's in our best interest, and if we have to take a balanced perspective, to improve all schools. Most black males go to traditional public schools. The numbers are clear. Right? And if there's not enough of these, you know, these high performing, I keep saying high performing because not all charters are high performing, there's not enough to go around, so we have to do what we can to address the true no child left behind, good intention. Who would disagree? Who wants to leave a child behind? Anybody? Good intention. Self-interest enters, right? Lack of resources to really fund and do the things that need to be done. In terms of a pro-con situation, so charters provide parents with choice. You hear this, parental choice, yes. How many of you all have kids? How many of you all want to be able to choose amongst a pool of schools? And you probably want to choose the best one, right? Makes sense for your kid, absolutely. All right, so the challenge with that is that often the more engaged, concerned parents will leave a traditional public school, weakening their PTAs, accountability, and possibly enrollment and funding per student. So then you have traditional schools that are under-enrolled, underfunded, and so forth, right? But you as a parent, you want the best choice, right? And this is the self-interest. I'm a parent. My child goes to a charter school. Because in my environment where I live, when I looked at the options, that was the best option. I mean, you know, I want the traditional, I wanted to send my child to a traditional public school. I really, really did. When we visited and we talked to the teacher, we saw what was going on, like, that's tough. I mean, real talk, y'all. Real talk, right? So these are where the self-interest comes in. So some other quick things. Most charters are created in high-needs areas. We need that. We're amongst several low-performing schools, but some low-performing schools may close prematurely, and a lot of this is going on now, due to not having enough time to turn things around after significant efforts have begun being made. That's why I like some of what you all are doing here. One, D.C., because D.C., you have 15-year charters. Is that right? Some schools. Okay, I thought we talked about that before. Some schools, some districts have 15-year charters. That's enough time to turn things around. If you have a traditional public school, you identify some issues, they say, okay, we're going to turn the school around. How much time do you really give them before you shut them down? Right? So we have these different things, and I'll wrap up with this. In terms of the voucher piece, good intention, right? Voucher says, I pay taxes. My taxes, right, and I might be in an affluent area, are supporting the public schools. Those public schools are not really that good. I want my child to go to a private school. Private tuition is really high. My taxes are going there. I want my child to go here. Why can't I pull some of my taxes over there via a voucher? Logically, you understand some of that. But on the other side, what is that going to do to the traditional public school, right? So a lot of times our tensions and our self-interest are at odds. But I'll end with this, and I'm a college professor. What policies, and this is the research I need to show, and maybe I need to read Sean's report. What policies correlate with, what's the end game? Is it a high school diploma? Is it high SAT scores or state scores? Is it college graduation from a four-year institution? Is it being gainfully employed? We need to agree on what the end game is, and then look at what policies correlate with the end game that we all value. I don't know what the consensus is around the end game. I would argue that the end game should be options, the intent, common core, ready for career versus college. Options, that sounds good. Execution-wise, we'll see how this plays out. Coming out of college, okay, I'm sorry. All right. So, I'll stop. But in terms of the policy, we have to agree on what the end game is and then what policies correlate with that. Okay.
Amen. Thank you, Dr. Marks.
Dr. Milner is going to discuss research and observations on the potential impact of the decentralization of schools due to closures and choice, and the realigning of educational priorities due to standards testing and creating uncertainty among many Black students and parents. All of that in 5 minutes.
All right. It's a huge task there. Jeff Johnson, I love your truth and your work.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here with us. And to Ivory and also Chance Lewis, who are on the front lines doing this work. I'm honored to be here and very grateful for this opportunity. In the spirit of Larry Davis, who is a social worker, who's actually the Dean of Social Work at the University of Pittsburgh, and also Derek Bell and critical race theorists all over the country, the world, really. I want to begin my long five-minute talk with a story. A storyteller reported that historically, U.S. car manufacturers such as General Motors and Ford Motor Company developed systems and practices that when a new car had been completed, that is, you know, when cars are completed, they come off the line, and once the car reached the end of the line and the car didn't work properly or it wouldn't start, U.S. practices had been for those technicians to push the car to the side, that is, to a designated area, and diagnose, that is, try to figure out what's wrong with the car. You know, we want to figure out what's happening with this car, right? Historically, Toyota, in contrast, when the same scenario would emerge, that is, when a car reached the end of the line and wouldn't start, rather than push the car to the side and try to figure out what's wrong with it, they actually stop the line itself, right, to figure out what's wrong with the line, right? You get me? Does that make sense? So in other words, the lines, the systems, the institutions are broken, not necessarily or always Black male students themselves or their families. I want to suggest that we're focusing on the wrong thing when we talk about Black males. We need to look at the systems. We need to look at the lines and try to figure out what's going on with the line rather than looking at the end report of these students. Indeed, there are serious challenges facing Black males. I want to share 5 institutional challenges that we might begin to or delve into more deeply related to Black males. And the first one is a narrow curriculum practices in pre-kindergarten through 12 classrooms. Don't miss this, you guys. We are spending so much of our effort and our time focusing in on language arts and mathematics. We are excluding other important content areas such as art, music, physical education, and the like. Even though we know there's hard science, there's good science that would suggest that everybody needs to be engaged in physical activity. And we look at rates of obesity and we look at rates of heart disease and so forth, even among the youngest of our Black male students. We know that these students should be actively involved in physical activity and physical education. Yet, we allow schools in many urban and high-need districts to streamline physical education and music and social studies even, right? All at the expense of trying to raise a test score. Teachers are teaching to tests, right, and not teaching to the responsive nature and the responsive needs of Black male students. So the first imperative, if you will, is related to the narrowing of curriculum practices in pre-kindergarten through 12 classrooms. The second imperative that I want to stress is institutional and individual racism. In this era of post-racial everything, I want to suggest that racism still is a critical issue, is a critical part of what we need to think about. The teaching force remains largely white, middle class, and female. And researchers have analyzed, let's say, for instance, archival data that have looked at thousands of referral patterns, for instance. And what the researchers have determined is, For the most part, teachers refer students to the office. Most referrals begin on the classroom level. And teachers refer students, Black male students, to the office for what they call subjective infractions, right? You know, little Johnny's so loud, he's rude, and so forth. White male students, in contrast, are referred to the office for more objective infractions. You were late. I look at my clock, it's 8:35. You should have been here at 8:35. You arrived at 8:40. That's objective. Yet, black male students are put out of the classroom disproportionately in these classrooms. And we've got to look at this and look at the role of race, the centrality of race in these decision making. We know there's a direct correlation, and Brother Moore said it clearly, between time on task, that is, there's a relationship between the amount of instructional time students get and their academic performance. And we wonder, we have a nerve to compare achievement data among and between students when we know that students, African-American male students in particular, are not getting a fair share. I'm moving quickly here. The third point that I think we need to really be mindful of, the first one was the narrowing of curriculum practices. The second one was institutional and individual racism. A third one is the under-preparation of teachers and teacher education. Teacher education programs, writ large, are doing a poor job of educating teachers to teach African-American students in general and African-American male students in particular. A review of the literature of some colleagues and I just conducted a review of the literature, and there's almost no research done at all on teacher education programs specifically designed to meet the needs of teachers who are teaching African-American male students. A third one is ineffective leadership. I'm out of time, I know. And then the fifth one is inadequate counseling and psychological services. What does not happen often enough in schools is support for black males who might be facing psychological challenges. For instance, counseling services can be critical for students who are grappling with death or other forms of trauma in their lives. Getting to the root of the problems of students and finding ways to address students is a task that schools must take on. Researchers such as Jeff Duncan Andrada and Ebony McGee and others have pointed to Columbine as a site of comparison. So the students at Columbine are still receiving support, y'all, for Columbine. And you know what? They should be, right? Yet we expect our African-American students to just deal with the trauma they experience on a day in and a day out basis. It's unfair. You know, give me a break. We are not meeting the needs of our children, and we sit back and we allow it to happen. So thank you.
Thanks, Doc. And last but certainly not least, Dr. Flowers.
Thank you. I'm very honored to be here with this esteemed panel and to be with all of you this morning. We've heard a lot of good information, and really we've heard most of the key issues. These scholars here have been doing their homework for many years. But a lot of what we've heard this morning, I think, is just somewhat consistent with what you probably knew or even experienced. And I think it's clear at this point that the underachievement of African-American males in our society has reached a critical level. When I say critical, I'm referring to the sense that now more than ever, we have to figure out a way to help our African-American males succeed in school. And while like you, I'm very aware of the high dropout rates and the high suspension rates and the fact that African-American males don't fare well on standardized tests, I still believe that the right mix of a multi-level approach and comprehensive legislation may help us to turn the corner, go in the right direction, and maybe even break some barriers. Mm-hmm. In other words, I really still believe, and perhaps I'm naive, but I hope that African-American males, that this is not the end of our story, and maybe just the beginning. In thinking about one important strand of this, Dr. Moore and I have been doing research on gifted education, and one of the strands of this multi-level success plan that we've identified, and many of us on the panel believe this, that perhaps expanding educational opportunities in gifted education may be a useful strategy. To sort of focus the attention of parents and educators and school leaders on identifying and selecting and appropriately testing African-American males to participate in gifted and talented programs. I think this is the belief of many of us that with an enhanced focus on gifted education and more specifically the role of testing in gifted education, we may be able to help more African-American young men to reach their potential, sort of changing the narrative, but focusing on academic outcomes at the highest level, gifted education. If you're looking at this issue, data from the U.S. Department of Education helps us to think about this. Over the past decade, we've been underrepresented, obviously, African-Americans and gifted and talented. Some estimates even suggest that approximately 3% of African-Americans make up the gifted and talented population in this country. To explore this issue at a deeper level for African-American males, Professor Moore and I analyzed some data from the Civil Rights Data Collection. We discovered that among the top 20 largest school districts, African-American males only made up 4% of the gifted and talented population. To sort of put that into perspective, there were 740,000 African-American males, and only 32,000 of them were in gifted and talented programs. In terms of thinking about some of the strategies and how we might be proactive to reverse this trend, I think one of the things we need to do is obviously contact the policymakers and perhaps get them to understand that we might need more federal oversight. We have the Javits Acts of 2001, but essentially that does not focus on these kinds of issues that we've been talking about, enhancing confidence and improving self-efficacy among African-American males, some of Albert Bandura's work. We perhaps need to even contact principals or superintendents to find out some of the requirements and testing procedures for ourselves so that we can understand how different and how somewhat complicated some of these requirements are. Many of us believe that there's way too much variation, really, in how students are tested and identified for gifted education. Way too much variation across this country. And perhaps some federal oversight and legislation might help us all. We also believe that there should be mandatory testing in terms of gifted education, and tests that are based on valid, reliable, and culturally relevant assessments. That would be nice. From a research perspective, I think it might be useful for maybe some of us to get together and compile a list of success stories about gifted education for black males so that we can sort of, you know, frame this for people that may not be aware of some of the positive benefits and what maybe some of the outcomes of these things. But we also need to ensure that once the black males are in these programs, that they're being taken care of. That the learning environment properly supports their talents and gifts. Of course, we need to continue to review the policies and practices used to test these students. Another step would be to provide training for educational personnel, as Dr. Miller said and other panelists have mentioned. We need more training in this area in terms of preparing future principals and teachers, in terms of their knowledge and values and skills, in terms of working with African-American males. While some of these recommendations and imperatives obviously will require a great deal of work and coordination and commitment, I think we can get there. We have to. I think we have the ability to help more African-American males develop their proper scholarly orientations in a manner that is consistent with our vision for the future. Thank you.
Thank all of you. The six of you outlined an incredible amount of work and research and potential areas of focus. And what this panel is about taking a look at that and then promoting policy advocacy and best practices. And so I'm hoping that your questions will be focused on policy advocacy and best practices. And I will make sure we're directed in that way. But I just have a few questions for the panel. I'm part of a group that has adopted a high school in Chicago, Harlan High. And Susan Taylor and some others had, I mean, placed full-time staff there, trying to provide students with not just academic support, but social support and mentoring. And there was a young man who I talked to while I was there. And he came up to me afterwards. You can see how brilliant he is. His grades may or may not reflect it. And he says, "Jeff, my biggest problem is everybody thinks I'm like my dad." Now, his dad's in his life, lives in his house, but he said, "My dad is a bona fide thug. And so when people see me, they assume that's what I am. My grandfather, who is also in my life, has worked for the city for the last 40 years. The only thing he knows how to teach me is how to go get a job. My problem is I have men in my life, but not the men who can help me become who I need to become. He said, but it ain't no program that can make men come here and be that for me. And so, Dr. Moore, I want to start with you on this notion of will that our young men need to have. But there's a correlating kind of reality that says, what is the will of the community? Mm-hmm. And where is the community's will, not necessarily by showing up, by advocating, by using agency, by being an example of that will for our young men who don't really know what it looks like? What are some either best practices that you've seen or recommendations that you have to be able to do that kind of work that in many ways is not legislatable?
Wow. No, I believe most of the challenges that our young men encounter, I think the community can break some of those barriers. And I say this, when you look at the Search Institute research, and they say there's 40 developmental assets, and the more you have, the better the students do in school and the better that they do in life. But this is what I notice in Columbus, and we're going to do a GIS project, is that many of the community resources are the same. And when I hear this term called social entrepreneurship, it's sexy, it sounds good, but all that means I got to go where the dollars are, right? And so we fight each other, because many people profit off black pain, even black people, right? And so the part of it is what I'm saying, how can we get all the organizations together in the community? This is one of the projects that we're trying to put together. And then do a community map and say, what are all the resources and what services you provide? Now, if it's 40 developmental assets, we gotta ensure that every student can get 40 developmental assets. If they say, the more you have, the better you do in life. And so one of the things that also that I can tell parents, whether you got a college education or whether you don't, if you eat with your child 3 or 4 times a day, those kids do better in school than those who don't. It's simplistic kinds of things. And not only that, the role of fictive kin, and that's in many ways the role that you play in. If you poor in America, I like to tell people this, you die poor unless someone bridges the gap. Boy Scout leader, coach, football, and those kinds of things. So I think we need to organize, and we haven't done a really good job of organizing. Now, I was quite outraged about the case, the Trayvon Martin case, but I said, what are we going to do about it? What about our schools? We got young brothers like him every day, and no one is outraged because their kids are not getting the quality education. So we need the community to organize in such a way to hold people accountable and to ensure that our young people get those kinds of services.
I want to ask one more question because we have a little over 30 minutes. I want to make sure you all have the balance of that time to be able to engage this panel. Dr. Marks, if I can come to you, you talked a lot about some of the policy priorities, what people are willing to do, where they're willing to do it. We've seen over the last 2 years a critical move by the Tea Party, especially in states like North Carolina, to get people elected to school boards. We haven't seen that kind of deliberate movement in our community, no matter how much we complain about the local policy issues or even the State Board of Education policy issues, that kind of mobilization to see people put in those offices. One, is it a viable strategy? And two, where do you think we can begin that kind of process to turn the tide?
Yes, I think it is a viable strategy. School boards have influence. There may be limits to their influence, but they had influence nonetheless. And to get African-American community, especially parents involved, is to educate them on how to join your school board, how to run, how to be elected. It can come through a strong PTA. If you have a strong PTA at a public school, they can really help you with a school council, school board run, right? So that community, the black church, the black church, I'm sorry, a lot of the things just came to mind, but the black church, if that pastor said, deacon such and such, We want him to run to the school board. We got a bunch of kids in here going to the local traditional public schools and not doing what they're supposed to do. We are going to put this person in place. That's what, well, I don't want to name corporations. That's what a lot of wealthy individuals in this country do. Yeah. They say, I want a congressman. I'm going to buy one. And they just put the money together and say, you're going to run, and they put the money in. So as a church, as a community, we can decide with some consensus, there's a problem. This person represents us well. Let's marshal our resources through the church, a community center, or a neighborhood association, whatever it is. But they have to understand that that's possible. I think a lot of us, school board, I mean, one is changing the psychology. It's possible. And then organizing our existing organizations and institutions in order to support them pursuing that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. The mic is open for any of you that have questions. And as you go to the mic, I ask that you would attempt to direct your question to one member of the panel if possible, that you would second ask a question, that you would third ask a question, fourth ask a question. I will give you 30 seconds to set up that question, at which point in time I will ask you, what is your question?
We have about 30 minutes, and that means we should be able to get a good number of questions asked if we're responsible. Yes, sir.
All right, hot seat. I'm going to put this away because that'll make it longer than 30 seconds. But the point came up around the importance of counseling and social support. I work for an organization called the National Black Gay Men's Advocacy Coalition, and there's been a lot of recent research and also a lot of spotlight on young black gay men who are committing suicide, who have lower rates of academic success because of these issues that are rooted around sex and sexuality. So how do we create these hubs that are rooted in black communities, but also, just as we talk about racism, we also talk about this issue around dealing with, you know, sexuality and young men who are dealing with those issues but don't have support systems in place that are rooted in black communities.
Thank you. Anyone want to take that?
Well, I'm a counselor by training, and I train school counselors, and some of the things that we have to do, that's content, that's information that that's not even brought in the curriculum. You know, the intersectionality of race, class, gender, and sexuality. And so those are critical things, but I'm a proponent of, and what we try to do in our training program, when we have some in the Columbus City Schools, is full service schools. And primarily because, guess what, depending on where you're located, rural or urban in particular, you don't have access to those resources because it's a backlog of individuals. So I'm saying that I think schools, and you can use your Title I dollars for these kinds of things, to partner with different agencies. But the partnership, and we should all repent, because higher education has failed K-12. We create ivory tower kinds of institutions, and really our work does no good for Sean to only read my work. It's important that our work is applicable and is disseminated to the community. So my proponent is, go back to what Brother Milner talked about. First of all, we got to talk about training. We got to make sure that people are equipped and they don't impose their values, their perspective on students, because not enough people who are trained to deal with young people. Mental wellness, and that's what I like to say, mental wellness. And so I think we need to think about it from that perspective.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Good morning, folks. Thank you for this great information. My name is Terrence McNeil. I'm a PhD candidate in educational leadership at Florida A&M University. And I'm studying technology integration amongst low-income groups. Dr. Marks, you spoke about this, and it's open for everyone. You spoke about the prison industrial complex, and I'm wondering if there's any appetite, any initiatives on a government level or anything that you've seen that is seeking to address young students where they are, if they might have been caught up in that system, and what are the latest things you've heard on that?
Thank you.
Okay, so without using this as an opportunity for an infomercial for the New York City Young Men's Initiative, I just think that it's important to acknowledge that $43 million annually is invested into that initiative. Now that sounds like a lot of money, right? $43 million sounds like a ton of money. It's the equivalent of what it costs to incarcerate 715 people in the state of New York. $43 million is what it takes to incarcerate those people. In Ohio, it's 1,600 people. It's the equivalent of $43 million. I think to dismantle this prison industrial complex and this sort of this pipeline to prison, that we should be more outraged as a community about the investment of public taxpayer dollars into the incarceration of people. I've argued in my work that we need to advocate for an incarceration education investment match. That seems reasonable to me. I'm encouraged by the work that we've seen in these New York City high schools, and I think that if we were to invest $43 million into early childhood education for black boys and for students from low-income families and so on, that we would not need to waste as much taxpayer money on incarcerating them at the latter stages of their lives. I just think that we need to be much smarter about the money that is wasted on incarceration.
But where are the progressive state legislatures that are even willing to discuss that? Because that's a state legislature issue at the end of the day, and what the state budget looks like.
My answer is, I don't know, but I suspect. So last Friday, I had the privilege of talking, giving a keynote to the National Black Caucus of State Legislators, and I'm telling you, here's how you know I'm from the South. I got the crunk in that session when I talked about these. They were turned up for sure. Left that session turned up, ready to go back to their states to wrestle with their colleagues around these incarceration issues.
Thank you.
Real quick,
please.
And with the prison piece, what is the purpose of prison? Right? They call it the Department of Corrections. What's being corrected? Right, we gotta think about what that term really means. If we're correcting so that they're more productive citizens, but we take away their rights, they can't give them federal loans, they can't get government services, can't live in public housing, we're taking all these options away, but we want them to be corrected. Right? What about in terms of the investment in education? While they're in prison, we come back to this education model of correcting. Because if they have more degrees you have, the less likely you are to recommit a crime.
Or just change the name to make it proper, which is the Department of Warehousing.
Yeah. Good morning, gentlemen. My name is Wally Smith. I'm from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and I'm a universal company. We manage 10 charter schools, two in Milwaukee. We just opened. The problem that we see, we have over 5,500 students, but our staff is like 85% other than us. And number two, in education, what can we do to make males educators sexy? Because what we find in Philadelphia is majority administrators are female, and the vice principal who has to put the hammer down is the male. So boys,
so let's take the question
real quick. So what can we do to get black males making education sexy again?
Thank you.
I want to jump in here. One of the things I want to make sure we remember is we're talking about prisons outside of school as if many kids are not experiencing prison-like experiences inside of school. So let's be clear about that. Many black males are in schools that treat them more like prisoners than they do folks who are developing and sort of cultivating intellectual curiosity and all the things that we hope they might get in an educational experience. I'll chime in here very quickly. There are pipeline programs related to mentoring programs, or pipeline programs, they call me Mr. Program, to get more black males in schools. The research in this area is a bit tricky, right? So some of the data would suggest that a black male teacher working with black and white students, the test scores are not don't correlate in ways that we would like for them to correlate. But when we look sociologically, right, when you look at the kinds of interactions that students have with the black with black men, the kinds of abilities that black males bring into the classroom from a pedagogical perspective, right, to make that thing real, to make that to draw connections and so forth, the data are clear that we need to do more about recruiting black males as well. But I also want to say that there are effective, the data are clear on this as well, there are effective white, middle class, female teachers working with black males as well, right? I've observed, and I'm just going to put it out there, I've been in classrooms with black teachers whom I would not want my children to be educated. Right. So we have some things that we have to address and be mindful of as well.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Good morning to you all. So I'm from the South Bronx in New York, and growing up, I had one black male teacher in public school, and no one in my neighborhood ever talked about college. You didn't see college students come back in any sort of capacity. And upon going to an Ivy League school, all of the people were going into investment banking or going straight to law school. I'm in law school myself, so I'm guilty of that. I taught before that. So my question is, how do political leaders, how do elected officials get involved in motivating people, especially people of color, to go back and pay it forward and go back to their communities, as opposed to just making money and going elsewhere?
Thank you.
I will say Chance Lewis did one of the few studies looking at black teachers, and black teachers, when you go in and teach it, it wasn't money. Money is not the reason why they didn't or why they did go into teaching. I think if my memory serves me correctly, they wanted to make a difference in other individuals' lives. Let's face it, you know, we need black male teachers, but we also need black males who can write the checks too. And some of them are not doing that, you know, and so we have to really have a room where all the black males come in the same room and say, we're not holding up to our part of the bargain in terms of making a contribution and then bringing black males to the fold. But I think some of the things that we have to do is to actually go there. Like on career day, when I go in Columbus City Schools, they tell them I'm a professor. I don't look like the professor that's been depicted to them. You know, I don't look like, if I do, they say, you don't look like Nutty Professor. You know, you got a bow tie, you know. But I told them I could. But I think there's some simplistic things. And most of us who did go into education, we had a dynamic teacher who was so transformative that impacted our lives in many ways. And so I think what we have to do is to constantly have the same kind of images that we have when we see LeBron showing somebody making the life of the mind, as Michael Dyson would say, very sexy.
Thank you. And let me make sure that the
Chance Lewis right here, he wrote it in Teachers College 2006. Chance, raise your hand so she'll know. But
these are going to be the last four questions, and hopefully we can get to all four of them. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. I'm Veronica Creech with First Book. We're a national nonprofit here in D.C. I'm also a self-identified pracademic. I am a practitioner who uses academic research and findings to inform our practice. My question is, direct, who will stand up to guide practitioners? When I often reach out to find data statistics to inform my organization, which we provide books to programs that serve low-income kids or kids from challenged communities, I'm trying to create the African-American collection or STEM collection for black boys. When I try to ask folks, what would that look like? Who could inform that? Nobody wants to stand by it.
So let me make sure that they have a chance to answer that question.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anybody on the panel? I think the real question is, one, if you can point to where, but if not, how, either institutionally or through partnerships, can practitioners connect in a more effective way to those that are doing the data and the research, correct?
And where's that research? Her question is.
Well, I
got you.
I'll say real quickly, it won't take long. You don't have to go too far. All you have to do is look at these individuals. Many of them run centers. They do this work consistently, and it really is work that reflects from elementary, middle, high, and even post-secondary. So I don't think you have to go too far. And all you have to do, there's a little
a strand that falls within them. You got people within this room, you got a dean right beside you of North Carolina A&T, and a lot of people don't know that they have a black male school on their campus. Name a college campus that has a black male school on your campus. How many here knew that? Mm-hmm. So best practices, how do black colleges continuously educate 22% of black America and produce the most pharmacists, the most teachers, the most judges? They're on our campus, the best practices. And sometimes you come to places like Ohio State, yeah, we do research, but there ain't many of us who do research on black people.
Adrian. Yeah, and I also just want to put the onus back on us, because I think researchers and academics have to do a way better job of making their findings actually translatable, relevant, and applicable to a lot of school communities. So what we're trying to do at the Research Alliance, for example, is anything that we find, we actually create school reports so that schools can get the information that we generate in a really applicable format, in a way that looks nice, in a way that doesn't take too long to digest and then translate into practice.
I think also with new media, there's some real opportunities for personalities to be able to connect with institutions, because so much of the conversation is around social issues and it's void of any data or research. And so I would love to talk to you all about getting research, but I think that folks like Roland Martin and Malcolm Monhill and Melissa Harris-Perry and others who are in this media space, as well as a multitude of bloggers who could really benefit from, and that could be a platform to be able to be that bridge between these institutions and the practitioners. Yes, ma'am.
Great. I actually have a comment just in response to the earlier questions about the incarceration rates and what states are doing. I'm Dr. Kendra Taylor. I'm an industrial engineer in Atlanta, Georgia. And our governor, a Republican governor actually, Governor Nathan Deal, has started an initiative to reduce the state's budget that is spent on the penitentiary system in Georgia. So as a researcher, I would encourage and actually ask that you kind of look more into that. I don't know all of the details, but as we know, there are in the past, we relate it to our juvenile justice system and our court system, there could be some subversive text under there that I don't know, and that it'd be good to have a researcher such as yourself look into.
Thanks so much for bringing that up.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, my name is Florence Williams. I'm from Teach for America out of New York City. And my question, or maybe some of my response, is to the panel. You talked about prison reform, but at the same token, you pay teachers below the poverty line, but you invest more in prison reform. What do you do about that?
Thank you.
Answers.
Anybody.
You all do teachers.
Nobody wants to talk about teacher pay?
Well, you know, I know teachers, I know we say teachers don't get paid, and they should get paid. And I wouldn't be here if I didn't have great teachers. But in some places in America, teachers make more than professors.
Yeah.
And so I know the narrative, because where I'm from South Carolina, they don't get paid as much, but they stay 40 or 50 years because they love teaching, and plus their retirements are not as good. And so I would suggest that it's the political will of the people. You know, do they want to have world-class schools? But when you look across the world, teachers are not getting paid as much either. But teaching is an intimate relationship, and it's a relationship that I think somehow the narrative has changed, that teachers say we were being required to do more. Well, my grandfather went to a Rosenwald school when they sent money to the South to educate black folk, and he's 94 years old. Teachers were the nurse, they were the teach, they the principal, they went to school, they were the Sunday school teacher. They certainly deserve more money, but the question is, the states haven't figured out what is the best methodology to pay teachers. And teaching is one of those professions, it's one of them old professions that society don't think you should get paid that kind of money. to educate someone. We think you should get paid more to be a lawyer. You go talking to a lawyer on the phone, he'll send me a bill of $800, and I ain't say nothing, but you know? And so I'm saying, we really have to change society's perspective. And this is one example of this. I never heard of levies until I went to Ohio. We didn't talk about levies in South Carolina. That, you know, they saying, if we don't get these levies, we're gonna lay off 1,300 teachers. Well, it's evident that the communities there don't think that education is worth me paying a little bit more taxes. And the paradox of it is, in suburban communities, we pay so much taxes in the little house I got in Fairfax, Virginia, that I'm saying, dang, I should be able to educate the whole continent of Africa. you know, but what I'm saying is, I think we have to do this kind of do the awareness, the campaigns, to get society to realize that we do need to pay teachers, and we need to pay them well. And I'm gonna give you this one example, and I'm gonna close. You in Teach for America. A lot of people have a lot of different opinions about it. I know they just came out with a report.
I just want to also make.
I
am not a teacher.
I'm
a telecommunications director.
Okay.
And I deal with Cisco. I deal on the digital voice side, but I do work for Teach for America.
Okay. And I'm saying that my biggest critique of Teach for America.
So you about to start something?
Yeah, I got two. Because I got the policymakers.
I just want to make sure this doesn't become a debate.
No, my biggest thing is,
remember, I'm from New York.
My biggest thing, vocation is calling.
Okay.
And most of them are not there for a career. I'm just here so I can get to law school.
Make it more attractive.
Right.
And the salaries. Make it more attractive, because I would not work for $35,000 a year as a teacher to get food stamps.
Wait. Because like I said, I knew this was going to happen. I told you.
Most teachers don't work for
$35,000. There's one more question, and I want to make sure I honor this sister who's the last person in line to be able to get her question before we close. And we got a ring set up next door so y'all can bow immediately following. It's pay-per-view, though. It's pay-per-view. Yes, ma'am.
It's not true. My name's Marsha Muhammad. I have a question. I am the health for the Holy Catholic Church. My question was to Dr. Moore.
Oh, boy.
Is Common Core the means in which congressional representatives will be moving money from our core accounts, the accounts we put in all of the government, including the CIA account, to help children or into a theater of war? I'll ask again. Is the Common Core that you mentioned the means in which the U.S. congressional representatives will move the money that we, meaning the Roman Catholic Church, puts into our core accounts, including the CIA, to aid children or for a theater of war?
Yeah.
Thank you.
There you go, brother. Maybe I should have let that debate continue.
I'm not a public intellectual, so I don't know if I can. what I will say though, I will just give you a historical parallel. I don't know if I have the expertise. These guys are a whole lot smarter than I am, so perhaps they can provide some input. But what I will say, even though I wasn't born, when Russia launched the Sputnik in the 50s, America tried numerous times. And we were so afraid of the Cold War that we put so much money into education. But education at that time, even though we didn't have a U.S. Department of Education, it wasn't educational, for the lack of the better terms, I'll say the U.S. Department of Ed, but I can't remember what it was called at that time. The burden didn't fall on within that unit. It became a U.S. defense initiative. The U.S. Department of Defense put the money into education in the STEM areas because they said they were so afraid of Russia and their science and their advancements. Here we are again in
2013, we had the same kind of fear of the world that everyone is getting accelerating much further than we are. But what I will say, when you read these national reports that everybody's doing better than us, we're not really comparing apples with apples. We're comparing apples with oranges. Everybody get a, for the most part, not they may not progress, but everybody get to take the test in the U.S. But when you go to China, only select people are getting to take the test. When you go in certain countries in Africa, only certain people. And usually those are the ones who are the most affluent, or those are the ones who are the most accelerated in those societies. I can't answer your question, but I bet if you stay here long enough, I'm sure somebody will be able to answer your question specifically.
Thank you so much, Dr. Moore. This has been, I think, a fantastic session. What I hope, and there have been a couple of questions that have really pushed to this, and Dr. Marks and I think it was Dr. Marks and Dr. Milner talked a little bit about what is it that what is our end game? And the end game is not about us from a research standpoint, it's from an action and mobilization standpoint. What do we want education delivery systems to look like in our community? And frankly, as I travel the country as a journalist and as an activist, most folks on the ground can't tell you what they want the end product to be. They can't tell you what should exist on that assembly line. They can't tell you what the quality control should be. And at some point, it's not about a kumbaya moment where we're all sitting around agreeing on what the right answer is, but it's at least six of us being willing to partner with the academic community and the research community, with activists, with elected officials, and with the business community to be able to create not just great individual schools that are a business opportunity, but new ecosystems of education that actually turn the needle. And so I hope that as you all leave this room, that is where you're thinking. Because too often in these spaces, we enjoy the intellectual stimulation, the conversation, and the research, but it only translates into socially conscious entertainment. And not real action and mobilization. So Dr. Tolson, thank you so much for putting this panel together. Thank you, panelists, for all that you continue to do. And thank all of you for filling this room on a topic that's incredibly important. Thank you.